So good afternoon, everyone. So welcome to Nanyang Business School's Alumni Dialogue Session. I'm really happy to see your faces here today. Before we begin, I'd just like to remind you to switch off your devices to silent mode during the dialogue session. So today's dialogue session is organised by NBS Alumni Office, as well as the NBS Marketing Division. I'm Assistant Professor Charlene Chen, and I'll be moderating today's session. Before we begin the session, please allow me to say a few things about our Marketing Division. So our Marketing Division has a vision of being the bridge between marketing academia and promoting thought leadership on cutting-edge marketing knowledge and technology. As part of our industry outreach, we organize talks by distinguished speakers. We sometimes participate in industry forums and workshops. And we also provide our expert opinion in professional publications like Harvard Business Review and WALK. And we also sometimes comment in the media as well. So here are some industry partners that we have been working with. So you can take a quick look. So if you'd like to find out more about future events, I would encourage you to check out our division website. We also have a Facebook page. And if you'd like to join our mailing list, you can email Ms. Jessie Tay. Okay? So thank you for attending today's dialogue session. Today, we're very privileged to have with us three amazing alumni who have done amazingly well in their careers, in their marketing careers. And so let me do a quick introduction for them. First, we have Mr. Kenneth Chu. He graduated from our accountancy program. Kenneth is currently the managing director of Heineken Asia Pacific. He is responsible for overseeing 10 operating companies in the Asia Pacific region. Since joining Heineken Asia Pacific in 2003, he has held a number of strategic positions, including CFO of APAC. Besides his role at Heineken, Kenneth also sits on the board of trustees for several non-profit organizations, including the National Kidney Foundation and APB Foundation. Next off, let me draw your attention to Ms. Fu Siu-Ting. So Siu-Ting graduated from our marketing program, our first batch of marketing students. Siu-Ting is currently the Chief Marketing Officer for HP Greater Asia. Since joining HP, she has held many important marketing roles, including Global Head of Marketing Strategy and Planning, print category for HP Inc. Siu-Ting is an established marketing leader with more than 2 decades of marketing experience in international consumer goods companies. So she has been at Unilever, Mars, Diageo, and Frontera. She has received many prestigious marketing accolades. Recently, she was recognized by Campaign Asia Pacific in their 2021 Asia Pacific Power List as one of the region's most influential marketers. Okay, a very, very important role. Okay, and last but not least, we have Mr. Stanley To. So Stanley graduated from our Hospitality and Tourism Management program. He's currently the Chief Customer Officer for Cycle and Carriage Singapore. As a member of their senior leadership team, he oversees the firm's strategy in driving customer-centric experiences, service delivery, and digital transformation. He works with world-class brands, including Mercedes-Benz, Kia, Mitsubishi, and Citroen. Although Stanley looks very youthful, he has been in marketing for some time, over 20 years, and has held several senior positions across the public service, MNCs, and SMEs. Kenneth, Siu-Ting, and Stanley, welcome home to NBS. Let's give them a round of applause.
Thank you.
So let's begin the conversation. I'm sure there have been many changes on campus since you graduated. So there are many new shops and eateries, and Yunnan Garden has undergone a major revamp. So have you gotten a chance to see the campus yet? How do you feel being back at NTU?
I it's been a long time that I came back in here, and suddenly I feel really youthful. And all the memories I had about, you know, learning about marketing and business here, but, you know, it's really refreshing. And to be able to come back and actually, you know, talk about marketing, actually. Yeah,
indeed. Walking back, coming up from the car park, and I said, wow, it just brings back the memories. And Prof, I was talking to Prof earlier, I was looking at the back row of the seat where, you know, that's my first choice when I come to a lecture theatre. Yeah.
Stanley, how about yourself?
For myself, I've been back to Yunnan Gardens. It's a really beautiful place. But I was just joking with Prof. Charlene that South Spine looks like it has stood the stand of time. It has not changed a fair bit. So it still looks the same like 20 years ago.
Right. So we know the management needs to do something about South Spine. We need some change here. So today we are going to discuss some very important issues that, of course, all marketers must know, hence the title of our talk today. So let's begin talking about the role of marketing in organizations. Perhaps you can share with us the strategic role that marketing plays in terms of your company's performance. Yeah.
Should we start with the ladies first? True marketing.
Okay. It's really strange that you're talking about the role of marketing when every day you're doing marketing. And then I try to recall back, you know, what did I learn in marketing in Kotler? I mean, marketing, you start with learning Kotler and then, you know, 4 P's and then everything. But I would say that if I just start from an academic perspective and how marketing is in the organization, it's quite simple. It's really rooted back to, you know, really knowing the human's mind. And understanding the human's mind and needs and motivation. And what we call it in business is who the customers is. And then actually, you know, understanding the customer insights and the human's mind. And then how do we actually develop products, services, and solutions that ultimately help drive business growth and actually business impact, which, you know, going back to Kenneth will be a good, example that we can have a little bit of battering here is I'm the CMO. So I basically I have to justify to the MD on, you know, what do I do? What kind of products do I drive in? What kind of innovation do I need to bring? How do I bring to customers in order to drive business results in the short term? So selling more alcohol or selling more Pampers or selling more any to really drive business growth in essence. So that is the fundamental, you know, role of marketing. And in organizations, it's been always been the case. Kenneth and Stanley, you want to talk a little bit more before I...
Yeah, I think fundamentally satisfying consumers' wants is still the fundamental of marketing 101. But I think that recent years, the role of marketing has really changed quite drastically. As we know, PDPA is becoming a big thing right now. So there's also a lot of focus on ESG activities and things like that. So I think the focus, it's a lot of people, when they come to me, especially some of the new employees that I interview and applying for marketing positions, they think that marketing is all about running ads, promotions, campaigns. But there's also the non-sexy part of marketing, which you know, you really got to do a lot of back-end work. There's research. There's a lot of data crunching. Sometimes if you are in online sales, you got to manage inventory. You got to manage financial systems, reporting, management reporting. So there's a lot of the more mundane tasks to marketing. So I think I usually tell the new joiners that, you know, there's the nice part of marketing, but there's also the mundane part. So you got to balance that a little bit.
Yeah, for me, marketing, if the question is about the strategic role of marketing, I think from a helicopter point of view, it's about creating value. So marketing is actually creating value. As an example, you look at a bottle of water, you know, you can actually drink a tap water, or you can pay $2 or $3 for a bottle of Evian. So what makes people willing to pay more? So marketeers are the ones that actually are the genius behind creating the value and what are the exchanges of values. And marketeers are the ones that actually smell out, you know, the consumer needs and then matches how this value exchange is going to be. So if you look at it, it's purely on a strategic point, really a business person. You know, knowing what value consumer is willing to pay, knowing what are the needs that consumer wants, and then matching them. So not all the time is every expensive thing that's going to do. Sometimes even on economic brands, etc. As long as you know where your niche is and matching it and creating that value. Yeah.
Really well said.
So it sounds like, you know, creating value has been what the role of marketing, you know, has been for a long time. But with what Stanley has mentioned, there's a lot of data crunching these days because it is, you know, now it's a big data generation, right? All the data analytics. So marketing students, you cannot be fearful of math and figures. Some of my students are here and they are worried. And besides just creating the needs, it's using the numbers to tell us what these needs are. So, I mean, some of you have been in marketing really long. I won't say how long. But has there anything been major that changed for you when you first started out? And right now, in your position, you know, how has the role of marketing evolved over time?
I can go first. I mean, I think fundamentally, Kenneth rightly talked about, which is really to create value. But having said that, the macro environment has changed largely. I mean, we know that. I remember when I first started being a brand manager, things are really simple. You kind of know that, you know, you just need, have to create a TV ad, and then you put a TV ad up there, and then you could actually understand how that really drives to brand equity and sell out. So simple. But the macro environment has changed so much because first, role of technology is different. You know, now it's no longer a linear approach. It's like a person can be looking at a handphone and talking about everything all the same time. Secondly, is really on data, right? The role of technology accelerate the way data comes through. Third is privacy law, like what Stanley says, has totally make it really, really difficult. Like, you know, we no longer can, it's going towards a cookie-less world. So it's really, really different. And then on top of that, the last 2 years has actually accelerated a total shift of, you know, how consumer really behave. You know, no longer it's like within expectations. First, everybody goes into work from home. Second is, you know, the whole social context has changed drastically. Your environment now is just, everything is within the home, in essence. So hence, the perception of how consumers really look at brands has shifted massively. So the role of marketing actually becomes even more challenging, you know, which is how do you really understand and really smell the customer's need? How do you actually even predict the customer's need and do something about it? It becomes very, very complex.
I think what Suting said is very on point. There are a lot of disruptions and new innovations coming up. So I think don't be afraid to say that, you know, we are still learning as well. When we first started, I think we do a lot of like your ATL, BTL. Yes. And then now it's about digital. I remember when we do a lot of advertising on Facebook and all that. You know, we thought that we have mastered Facebook, then there's Instagram, you know. And now when I talk to my young nephew about Facebook, right, they think it's for the old people. It's for the old people. Now, even Instagram is becoming for the old people. They are talking about TikTok now. Yeah. So I think we are all constantly learning. So I think the strategic part about marketing and the role is that sometimes a good marketer will be able to predict what's upcoming. You know, what's going to be sunsetting, what's going to be the new trend. And I think it is this intuition and business vision that is very critical in marketer.
Yeah. Indeed, the traditional and very conservative view of marketing was, oh, let's create a TVC. Mm-hmm. And oh, let's create an event and let's activate and get everyone excited and know our product from there. It's actually go way beyond today. So like what Stanley was saying, Facebook, actually just maybe 7-8 years back, or even you go 10 years back when Facebook was started, we all went for the number of likes. Mm-hmm. You know, we all said, yeah, your brand, your campaign, how many likes have you got? And it takes us about 4 or 5 years to realize that, hey, number of likes on Facebook doesn't count anything at all towards conversion to purchases. Mm-hmm. So that's something that we learn as well. So what Stanley is saying is important as we go along when new things are coming. Now we are watching what TikToks we're going to do. You know, how do we activate stuff on TikToks and get more impact, right? The key thing, of course, is when you have an event or you have something to show, you want that to be converted to action. You want that to be converted to purchases. So the engagement is pretty important. So one of the things that for us, Heineken at least, we are, our big target market is really Gen Z. right? We are always going for the youngest crowd, and you know what is really important to them. So for me, I'm not an expert in Gen Z versus the Gen Z, even though I own 4 Gen Zs myself. But at the end of the day, it's really knowing what they really want, what it's meant to them, which we'll talk a little bit later on in the trends that we need to be more looking into. And then how do you make your product sell to them? What does Gen Z want? So just an example of what marketing is really getting really curious about what your target audience want at the end of the day. Most of the brands, most of the progressive brands are looking at this new crowd, new generation, and then to say what you sell to them, the rest will follow. Yeah?
So I think Kenneth clearly knows the Gen Z. He's already dressing like a Gen Z. And, you know, you talked about knowing what they want. And I know you have a latest campaign, right, with The Zero. Would you like to share a bit about that?
Indeed. Maybe I give... Thanks, Prof, for reminding me of this. It's one that I wanted to share with everyone is that knowing what the consumer needs when they don't even know what they need. And the surprising thing about really going deep inside and deciding on doing something that wasn't our core business. So maybe you watch and then we can talk a little bit more.
Very superstitious. Writings on the wall. Very superstitious. Letters by the fall. Sexy motto baby. Broke the looking glass. See me in the daydream. Keep me on the shore. You don't say me. Sad is all. When you believe in me, but you don't understand the neck of the superstition ain't the way.
Like it? Yes. Yeah, so this is one of the things that I'm terribly proud of. That's Heineken has been the same since 1865. And we have grown and grown. But suddenly, we only launched this product 3 years ago, that we realized that there is something that everyone wants. Not everyone wants to drink beer all the time. So, but everyone wants to be connected, want to be seen, and don't want to be left out. So we came out with a product that it tastes like beer, but there's no alcohol in it. So within 3 years, we actually conquered that segment totally and in all the market. And at the end of the day, it helps build our brand even further. So that's one of the things that maybe you can call it as a disruption, that we are doing very, very differently, thinking out of the box. But if you keep thinking the same straight line, you won't come up with an idea like this.
So I think that makes a good segue. You know, we talk about disruption. That's something on all our minds now as marketers, right? How do we react to disruption or even anticipate some of these disruptions? And, you know, in this new normal with COVID and with, you know, all the recent trends in the environment. So, you know, maybe talk about some of these marketing strategies that, you know, were in anticipation of some of this disruption or in reaction to these disruptions? And what were the thought processes underlying these strategic changes?
I would say that when pandemic happened first 2 months, well, the rule book of marketing or rule book of running business is totally torn out, out of the box. I think first is literally almost like, how do you survive? And it's almost like, are you able to sell your product? I mean, for the alcohol industry, it will be really very much, you know, your normal way of selling is not there. I mean, for HP, you know, where that pandemic happened, what we literally saw was, because in HP we had, we sell to consumers and customers, but we also have a big part of business that sells to business. So the business side, everybody no longer go to office, so that business totally went down. And then we have to pivot very, very quickly into the channel. So really, you have to go into all online channels. You have to be really relevant in all online channels, in essence. Then on top of that, the big part of that was consumer behaviors shifted massively, because everything, like I said, is really all from, you know, evolving and work from home. And everybody's coping from, you know, imagine you're actually working and at the same time, your kid is actually with you doing pee. So then the usual customer behavior totally is not predictable. And I guess it goes back to what Kenneth says, is ultimately is that curiosity to really understand how did the customer mindset literally shifted. And if we start from that position and really understanding that, that was, you know, really helpful. So I think the disruption, what I said for the first 2 years was, first we realized that the way you sell and the way you market has to totally change. The second piece is obviously the first thing to do is to survive, marketing budget gets cut. So as marketers and CMO, the first thing is you need to justify why you're doing that. So you've got to really be very data-centric and say, because of doing this, it actually drives X amount in essence. Now, after 2 years of pandemic, what we're also seeing from a macro level, the Gen Z, now you talk Gen Z and want to talk Gen Z too, because I'm also quite Gen Z. But anyway, the Gen Z expectations of brands totally shifted. So they're really looking at brands that is not only giving me a product that's cool, they're also looking at products that, you know, that does this brand, is it purposeful? Second of all, fundamental basics is this brand really, really being authentic to the values? And then is it also into the whole sustainability, you know, D&I piece? So, you know, last time, many years ago, sustainability purpose is like kind of a talk. Now it's no, now it's basic. You got almost got to pivot very quickly into that area. So I would say these are some of the disruption that really happened. Yeah.
And for HP, that would also be difficult, right? Because how is the paperless movement affected you guys?
It's definitely very, 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 very difficult in essence, because we have laptop business and also we have print business in essence. So I think on the laptop side, you know, obviously we saw a huge surge into laptop. We really ran out of stocks of laptop in essence, and printer also really happened. I think for printing side, I think what we advocate to do is at least every part of the value chain really subscribe to helping, you know, sustainability and really promote sustainability. And also, you know, some of our products, you know, we go back to paying back to the society in terms of returning to that. And also the cartridges that we do is also part of recycling process.
Stanley?
I think before we jump into thinking of what to do, I think it's important to understand what type of disruptions is affecting us. So I think if we look at the environmental level, you have the Ukraine war happening. Of course, we talk about COVID all the time. Suting mentioned about ESG issues. And recently, I'm sure everybody knows about the OCBC scam. So there's a lot of data security issues. So these are all things that sometimes it just happens out of nowhere. Second level is really at the more industry level. So I think in terms of automotive, I'm sure everybody is knowing about the rising popularity of EVs. We also talk about new consumer behavior like car sharing. So, you know, some of the very popular brands out there. Some people also find that they no longer want to own a car, but they want to lease a car. Since owning a car, it's you own it for 10 years, it's not really owning anyway. So I think the consumer behavior is changing. And I think at a personal level, at an individual level, I think Suting has also mentioned quite a fair bit about the changing work from home type of arrangements. A lot of companies are pivoting towards digital. So there's also business transformation. The role of marketing is quite different. You're given less budget and it is often during the times where you have very little budget that you try to do something really creative and innovative. So there's something good out of it as well. So I think it's also important to look at the silver lining in all of this, because I was just talking to one of my friends that if without COVID, right, there won't be such a fast push for digitalization. You know, we have been toying with the whole idea of like, can we make people work from home and all that? But suddenly this COVID just make it happen, you know, and a lot of things, you need that push to make it happen. So I think it's quite critical to be able to be very adaptable, you know, to changes and all that.
Yeah, just building on Suiting and Stanley saying, one is that the consumer Gen Zs are shaping consumerism. And two is the environment is changing. You know, you have COVID, you have Ukraine war, etc. But actually disruption already started happening when this thing came onto our lap, right? When the phone comes in, you know, everyone starts to spend these 8 hours on the phone. My son is spending 14 hours a day. So things are that this changes everything. This changes how we communicate. This changes how we plan. How do we interact? So one is for marketing. We talked earlier about marketing, creating value and how we communicate to people, etc. It changes the way we think, how we want to communicate. So one of the things is that the challenges for marketers is that with this, everything changes. All the variables are changing. What do you do? And what decision are you making? Because your budget is going down, your company budget is. So how do you be more efficient? You know, there are no low-hanging fruits. If there are low-hanging fruits, I do A, B, or C, someone would have already thought about it. So it gives you more opportunities to be creative about what things you do at the end of the day. So one of the disruption I wanted to share with Prof earlier, so maybe we'll see a video earlier, is a disruption that happened in my company about advertising spend. When we look at advertising spend, we say, hey, look, COVID, our customers are suffering. The bars and pubs are closing. They are suffering themselves. And our own marketing budget is going down. What do we do? So one of the way to think about it is maybe illustrate by a video. Then you can see it a bit clearer. Yeah. Sorry, I came from a company with a lot of videos. So for meetings, we always watch videos.
One of the hardest things in my life was to see our bar shut and our doors closed.
About 60% of closed businesses that won't be reopening.
Experts say it could take 4 to 5 years to recover.
Que piensa de verdad en el hotelero.
Es como un besar de cero.
So this is one of the clever tricks. And there's nothing rocket science about it, but it's just switching a budget, right, from an outdoor TVC and giving it to your customers who's going to buy beer from you later on. So that's something that we're super proud of. But the under layer of it is what Suiting was saying. Your consumers are looking at you. how real you are. You know, you're really being authentic about it. You really care for your customers, and then you really act on it. So those are things that more and more challenges for marketers is that how do you be authentic? How do you really know your products and serve the needs? It's no longer saying nice creative words and nice graphics, but actions and products, and especially addressing things that is important for our environment, that's addressing about care, and Gen Z's, the key words is inclusion and diversity. So those are things that, you know, marketers need to really know and feel about it and think and live through every day. You know, these are the things that we have to create. We have to create that values because those are values that you guys all feel, and then you should think along that line. Yeah.
I think, you know, a lot of the things that you are saying is also in line with the ESG revolution that's really happening, right? And these days, marketers are not just selling products anymore.
That's right.
We're really fighting for causes and showing that we are, you know, making a stand even. And it's tricky in this environment. So has there been anything in particular that your companies have done in response to this ESG revolution? Is there some strategic shift or strategic change that you see allowing you to meet the needs of this revolution?
I don't think it's really triggered off by pandemic. Mm-hmm. You know, I think for brands that are quite purposeful, and I think I was just very fortunate, not only in HP, but in my previous life with Diageo, I work for brands that are really, you know, being purposeful. So, you know, a big part of that was already a big piece is not only looking at marketing on the brand's perspective, but also in terms of employer brand. So, for example, in HP and even with my previous company, Diageo and alcohol companies, diversity and inclusion is a very big part of who we stand for. So, I would say that in response of ESG, my personal view, and this is just my personal view, is I'm not a big believer of a lot of talking. You know, you can talk and talk and talk. I think it's more about acting on it. Right. So for example, some of the actions that I take as a marketing leader is, you know, really make sure that in my team I have a diverse metric. So, and a succession planning, there's a diverse metric. And also, given the fact that we're marketing to Gen Z, having Gen Z come in into the organization becomes really, really important. You know, I remember what Stanley was saying. I actually learned about digital marketing not actually to an intern. So I actually got an intern that worked for me and I said, you go and learn everything about digital marketing, but actually I was actually stealing. I was doing peer learning. So I would say diversity and inclusion in terms of an act, in essence. And I think sustainability now, a lot of people talk about it. It really has to show up in your products, you know, what the products is really being made of, how your supply chain is. So I think that's my point of view.
I think it's very applicable to my industry because I think we use a fair bit of like single-use plastics, all the lubricants that comes in it. Of course, the wastewater that we use to wash the car. And of course, treatment of e-waste, for example, like the car batteries and things like that. So I think the push for the focus towards ESG issues is really from both investors and end of the day, consumers themselves. So I think there are, in my opinion, there are around five areas that how ESG benefits a consumer or a company. I think from the bottom line point of view, when we focus on ESG, especially like your scope one and scope two of carbon emissions, scope one refers to like the ways that you generate, the electricity that you use and all that. Scope two is basically the resources you pay to people who supply you the energy and all that. And I think definitely by reducing all of this, you cut your cost. So when you cut your cost, some of the suppliers may then pass back some of the savings to the customer. Secondly, I think for us, regulatory is also a very big thing. So I think for the past 2 years, there's been government incentives as well as penalties towards like emission standards. So you have the vehicular emission scheme, or VES for short. So basically, if you buy a very green vehicle like an EV, you get rebates, and that rebate is basically benefiting the consumer, right? You pay less with of a lower price and all that. So I think these are all initiatives to benefit the end consumer. And I think touching on, I think Siu-Ting and Kenneth has mentioned, the Gen Zs are very passionate about the environment, you know, sustainability issues and all that. And by having a very strong focus on such issues, you also create a very positive brand perception and association. So I think us as consumers, sometimes you feel better that you are using something that's biodegradable. You're not using like a facial wash with like little beads that, you know, the poor fishes are going to eat, you know, when it goes to the ocean and things like that. So I think the part about improvement in brand perceptions is also quite important. And the other part is about investors. So I think Jardine Cycle and Carriage, being a listed company, obviously we account to our investors, and there's also investors' pressure on wanting to focus on sustainability issues and all that. So I think these few points are also quite critical for us to take note of. And I think lastly, we talk about the bottom line. The top line is also very important. So naturally, when you have improved brand perception, you have products that appeal to Gen Zs, the new consumers, your revenue and all that will go up, and you manage to get better sales and all that.
Thank you. I'd like to share two things. One is that my company happened to be the key brands that we have as well. So what's happening on the brand side and what's happening on the company side? So on the brand side, the Heineken brand, in the 80s and 90s, it's all about the liquid. You know, our focus is about the liquid, high quality. Look at how clear the liquid is. How delicious is it? Look at the bubbles. It comes out crystal clear. And that's the communication that we have that we think the consumer wants. And then going towards the early 2000s, we focus on the consumer. Whoever drink Heineken is a hero. You know, it's so cool. And then you're the man of the world. That you when you hold that bottle, you look really cool about it. That's what we focus on. But the shift now, as what Siu-Ting was saying, you know, the Gen Z is going towards inclusion and diversity. The brand now talks about breaking down barriers and sparking connections, so connecting people and breaking down barriers. We pride ourselves as, you know, the first Facebook of the 1800s. We're actually connecting people since 1800s because beer is the connector. So now our brand purpose is moving towards that. So when we see how we communicate, how people choose our product, is a vote for connections, is a vote for inclusion. So that's how we align our values, of the brand values, to what consumer values wants, particularly what Gen Z wants. The other one that's interesting is how my company shifted our company purpose in this light as well. So we have been, maybe if I take 20 years ago, we call ourselves a proud, leading, and independent brewer in the world. You know, what's our purpose? We want to be a loud, proud, leading, and independent. Proud because we are always so proud about our quality, because we are the best in class. We get the best malt. You know, we use the best water. So we are very proud about that. You know, quality comes first. Still today, yeah? So if you choose, you still have to choose Heineken. Independent, because the company is controlled by the Heineken family. So we are independent, right? And leading. We want to be a world-leading company from there. But only last year, the COVID has shifted us thinking, actually, what really is our company purpose? So we got our top 100 people in the company brainstorm, discuss about it. And the shift, interestingly, we shifted away. And they said, what is really our purpose? So our purpose is to brew the joy of true togetherness and inspire a better world. So that is something that's a purpose that we put in, and whatever we do is fulfilling that purpose. So the joy of true togetherness is again a connection part. So that's very much how these things have shifted, and that's how marketing has also shifted as well. looking at what the consumer needs and how we fulfill the consumer needs as well.
Right. And it's almost like, you know, there's this huge following of ESG and sustainability inclusion. Everybody's jumping on the bandwagon. But at the same time, I think one of the things that came across in our conversation is this meaning of authenticity, right? Because at the end of the day, each company has their own vision and business strategy. And, you know, just jumping on the bandwagon may not be something that fits the brand. They have to do it in a way that still fits their personality, the values that they stand for. I think that is the tricky part and yet exciting part about marketing. So, you know, we have a lot of aspiring marketing leaders in our audience. So perhaps you could share with us, what do you think are the skills that marketers should have to meet the needs of the future? A lot of our young marketers here, I think, would benefit from this sharing.
Me again?
Young marketers.
I would say, I tend to say that to my team quite a fair bit, or whenever I'm being asked about what are the traits, I would tend to say, actually, marketing is, you need to have the art and you need to have the science of marketing. And the big art of marketing is really about, you know, the human insight and the curiosity, you know, and that creativity, right? You know, it's almost like you draw a painting, that aspect of it. That's a big part of marketing. But then on top of that, you need to have the science part of the marketing, which is you got to be really comfortable with looking at data and understand data, you know, especially in the digital world now. You cannot be a great marketer that just look at creating ads, but really the data side of it, how do you actually look at data and predict trends and actually justify that to revenue and brand equity is actually really, really important. So I would say, really look at it, you know, whenever you, you know, that's kind of the skill set perspective from a marketer standpoint. But then I would take one step back and also look at what are the qualities of a marketeer. For those of you who might be familiar and read marketing articles and whatever out there, CMOs actually is the shortest tenure of C-suite now. I mean, the tenure of CMO is usually no more than 2 years. Thank God I'm still around, but yeah, so really no more than 2 years, because the role of marketing has shifted so much. So that also means that to be a great marketer and great CMO, your leadership skills becomes really important, because you need to be able to sell your marketing function internally. You got to be the best connector, in the sense that you can align a CFO, you can align an MD, you can align an IT guy into something. So leadership quality becomes a very important part, because it's a huge part in marketing, especially when you get more senior. It's all about internal stakeholder marketing management. And it's also all about, you know, not only being able to create itself, it's also how you brand yourself, how do you tell stories. So how do you brand not only the brand, how do you brand marketing internally? And I would actually bring my own example, because my first 20 years of experience, I was in CPG companies. So Unilever, Procter, Diageo, Heineken. In these companies, marketing is at the heart of what we do, because, you know, everybody understands what marketing role is. It's just marketing and sales coming together. The last 4 years, I've been in a tech company whereby it's slightly different. Marketing is not really at the heart of the business. The business in tech is actually run by engineers and also salespeople. So you got to kind of, you know, really take the humble pie, be really curious, but be really, really resourceful to say, hey, what do you think? And be that customer's voice and connect everyone. So the soft skills become actually really, really critical. I can keep on talking about this topic, but
I think the fundamentals of marketing, it's quite everlasting and quite constant. So I think so long as end of the day, you are really serving a consumer need, it's about customer centricity. So I think all these are values and functions that really stand the test of time. So I think they are quite constant. So you don't deviate too much from that. But I totally agree that we still think that personal branding is very important. So other than establishing whatever you're doing, it is important to set a brand for yourself, what you stand for, what type of quality and value add you bring to the business and all that. I'm beginning to observe that a lot of the challenges on the marketer because of the company is cost cutting, or that there's a smaller team size, you know, in the marketing function and all that. So it becomes a lot more challenging for every marketer to be the jack of all trades. It's not surprising that, you know, your boss may want you to be able to elevate yourself to 80,000 feet and think about the strategy and the high level things. But you must be also be able to come down to the ground and do actual execution, you know. So I think the ability to elevate yourself to that level and then down to earth and all that, I think it's quite important. And in marketing, I think sometimes there's a lot of fluff going on. Yeah. So I think if you deal a lot with agencies and all that, some people will tell you a lot of fluff and all that. End of the day, I think we have to be very true to yourself because every one of us is a consumer. So you just ask yourself, will you appeal to this concept? Will you appeal to this ad? Will you appeal to this promotion? So I think being very true to that consumer sentiment is quite critical as well. And I think the last part is that I think every marketer should learn to be very adaptable. I think we talk a lot about disruptions and all that. So I think being open to changes and always ready to pivot, you know, towards digital, towards other channels is very critical. Because if you stick to what used to work in the past and try to, you know, not jump into the future or what's upcoming into the future, I think you will get defunct quite quickly.
Generally, for us at our senior management level, when we're looking at new graduates who join us, new colleagues who join us, and then we look at a potential, whether the person is this potential marketing manager or not. The first impression is how you present. The first impression is how do you tell your story? Wow, this one is a good storyteller, got a potential to be a marketeer. So I think first thing, Suting mentioned a little bit storytelling. That is still there. You know, maybe 50 years ago is still there. But 50 years ago could be worth 80% of the whole thing, storytelling. But today, maybe about 15%. That you still need the storytelling because that is the first impression. If you cannot tell your story as a non-starter, right, then it goes into the deeper part. The deeper part is really, first thing for me is curiosity. I think Suting also mentioned that earlier, so just stealing what she said. I think core of it all is, do you have a curious mindset? You know, you always ask your, because marketing, you talk about in consumerism, is about, you know, what does consumer want? Why do they want to buy these? Why do they willing to pay that more? You know, why do they prefer yellow color than red color? And all these questions you need to ask. But if you stop asking, you stop being curious, then there are some areas that you don't look at, then maybe you're not such a great marketer. But the more you ask, the more people answer you, and the more you can find the answers, the more targeted you can be. Second one is about a nose for business, right? Because I said earlier, marketeers are the one that control the exchange of values. So actually in my company, marketeers also tell us, you know, what you can price the beer at, how much. You know, knowing how much the consumer surplus is. So you have a nose for value and how you know how much your consumer are willing to pay more for, right? So you need to know the nose. You know, there's a little bit about data analytics. Don't go to the dry, boring stuff. But at the end of the day, making money is interesting. You know, making your consumer willing to pay more for you is interesting. So be curious about it. And have a business said, maybe I add a little bit more ribbon here, they pay me more money. Okay, maybe that's something that they like. Maybe if I adjust my brand communication into this area about inclusion and diversity, more people want to jump onto the bus. Okay, good idea. So once you get into that business sense, Then it goes into the, another deeper part, getting the job done. You know, that's what Stanley is saying. So it's not just storytelling, it's not just curiosity, but getting the job done. So a lot of it, people say, say only, say here, say there, but nothing get done. NATO, you know, no action, talk only. But at any of the day, if you really get into it, then the real marketeer, especially at the entry level, you know, be humble and do the job. Then you get your path to there to be a successful marketeer.
I'm hearing a lot of very key learning lessons, being about customer-centric and, you know, oftentimes you guys are really representing the customer's voice within your organization, right? Trying to sell to the management, hey, this is what customers are thinking about. And I really totally agree with you about the curiosity part, extremely important. So to our next generation of marketing leaders, keep being curious. Keeping abreast of what's happening in the world, because everyone's going to change, constantly change, right? And we need to be, you know, keeping up with the times. So right now, I would like to open the floor for questions. We have quite a few from our online audience. So let me take a quick look at our Slido. All right, so those online, you are welcome to post questions as well. Please join our Slido. On the screen, you can see the number and the QR code. So while people are typing their questions, we already have some who have previously typed their questions. So actually, one is directed to Stanley. So maybe I'll go for Stanley. You can go for it. So how does Cycle & Carriage differentiate itself when customers come for OEM brands such as Mercedes-Benz?
Yeah. Right. So as all of you know, Cycle & Carriage is a dealership. So we don't manufacture the cars. So the cars come from Mercedes, which is under Daimler, the company called Daimler. So if you look at the new model of selling, some of the new brands in the market like Tesla, they are actually going direct to consumers. They basically want to cut out the dealership and maybe that brings like lower cost to consumers and so on and so forth. So I think it's a very pivoting point for the automotive industry. So one of our core strategy is actually many, many years ago, we already anticipate this change in the selling model. And we have been thinking quite hard on what should we do, you know? And we start asking ourselves, what value can we bring to the table? And if you talk about very high involvement product like a car, right? Like today, the COE price can go up to over 90,000. So it's a very, very high involvement product. The most important part that goes in the consumer's mind is that not just the sales part, but what about the after sales? You know, the warranty, you know, if something happens to my car, can I get a reliable team to fix it? You know, you have a lot of horror stories from independent workshops out there that does something funny to your car and you cannot really check what they do to your car or do they really replace the parts with new parts or whatever. So I think we start to realize that our value add in this whole chain is really the service aspects of it. So it's really the service delivery. It's really our people and the service culture. So about 4 years ago, we rebranded ourselves. So before that, our tagline is actually we drive first class. So if you think of the tagline, we drive first class, the very imagery you think of, for example, if you think of like Singapore Airlines first class, you think of the seat, you know, and all that. But not many people think of the service aspect as a first drawn, you know, to your mind. It's always the physical product. So we start to pivot towards more service and people related. So we rebranded ourselves to Exceptional Journeys. So it's not about the product, but it's about the journey with us that we try to make it exceptional for you. So we focus a lot on delivering a good customer experience and a good customer service. And that kind of like help us counter this problem.
Right. I think there's another related question. It's open to all of you, in fact. So let me just pick this. How would you say marketing differs from product management? So it's kind of related to what Stanley was saying. So I just want to open it up to the other two speakers as well.
I think it's fundamentally the same because I think Kenneth rightly pointed out that, you know, marketing at the end of the day is understanding the needs and the wants, and then you create something for it. And then a big part of creating something for it is what you're selling, right? And the product is a part of that. And the product in CPG company come in the form of a physical product. But then when you go into the service industry, like hotel, is really the whole package of the service. So I would say marketing is the root of everything. And I guess the question will be really coming more from in industries, right? In some industries, you know, product management tends to be separated from the role of marketing. And I think for the current industry that I'm in now, tech is a classic example whereby you have product people that owns the marketing of developing of the product, and then you have marketing that takes the product and market it. Mm. But I would say that they are functionally they are the same, you know, in essence. It's just that you have to look at it from an industry standpoint and say, hey, in this industry, how does product plays, right? For tech companies, obviously the product is really critical. There's aspect of it that is more sophisticated. That's why you need, you know, a more skill set on engineering that really drives that. But marketing is the root and heart of everything, because you understand the customer insights, you develop the product, then you go and sell it, then you go and convince people to sell it.
Well, I think the question comes from maybe looking at innovations. And if you think about product management, maybe you're thinking about, you know, what's the difference between an iPhone 4 and iPhone 13 Pro Max, right? So you talk about innovations in the product stage by stage. I think the marketing also play a part in that, in staging this. They probably have already thought about iPhone 20 when they already launched iPhone 13, right? And sorted out and have the model ready. So marketers are saying, no, don't add all these things first. Sell this first and max it out. And then 1 year later, sell the next innovations and next innovations. So it's product management maybe is about managing your innovation funnel. You know, how much of it is going to come. And then when it's not enough innovation coming up, you really have to pump up your engineers and say, I really need more innovations to come up. So not every product has to go through. So that, like, for example, for water, it's most difficult to innovate. Water is water, right? You can sell a different water later on. You can change your bottle, but it doesn't change that. For Heineken beer is 1865, and today is the same recipe that goes through. So how do we do that? How do we do difference in terms of packaging, in terms of the way that we deliver, in terms of we communicate? So if I hope that makes a difference there.
So let's pivot and look at some questions here on some actual marketing examples or experiences you had. So here's a question from Wayne. In your combined years of experience, were there any occasions in which you were handed a struggling portfolio? What was the turnaround strategy that you implemented? What are some key factors that you had to consider? Did you guys have any experiences related to this? Kenneth is nodding his head. Would you like to share first?
Okay. Struggling portfolio. I think it's always very difficult to launch a new brand when there are established brands around. So in my company, you know, Heineken is the most established brand. We own Tiger as well. Tiger is also part of the brand that goes on. But when we start to introduce new brands, it struggles and it's difficult because one, the two big brands has got more budget than the new brands, right? And two is you need to communicate more on the new brands than the other two to overcome it. So why would people buy your product? In a sense that you have to create enough curiosity from your customer. You have to address a special needs of the customer. So for example, I showed you a success earlier, which is Heineken 00. It's a new product, part of the same brand, but something different, right? No alcohol. But if I introduce another beer with alcohol, et cetera, it's quite difficult to do so. So there are some brands, particularly when we try to price it in the mainstream level, maybe not Singapore, but in some developing markets, it's really difficult to drive that and get reach And how does this, at the end of the day, where do we learn and how? It's that one is you need to be persistent. If you look at your plan and then you need to do a long-term plan and say, look, maybe it takes me 3 years to stick on consumer mind that this product is real. You know, I need this product. So those are the learnings. But if you look at a short-term measure, like 1 year, 2 years, your result doesn't come in. It's very, very demotivating for marketers, right? You do a product nobody buy, or then you spend a lot of money. Your boss look at you, hey, why are you spending so much market money? And then the products are not selling. So I think a lot of it is also managing expectation. You know, when you launch a product and you say, look, maybe this thing will happen in year three. Yeah, year one and year two, let's be patient and then let's spend money on making the product known.
Thanks.
I think it's important not to jump into solutioning mode, because I think as humans, right, our brain is wired to solve problems. So immediately when such an issue happens, right, we want to jump into like, what can I do? What can I save the struggling business and all that? But before that, right, I think it's very important to first understand the problem. So in this case, the problem is a struggling portfolio. So what exactly caused the struggling portfolio? And when you talk about the problem and understanding a problem, you must always look at root cause versus the symptoms. And I think that's very, very important. Because if you resolve things that's symptomatic, obviously, the problem is still there. You are basically kicking the can down the road, right? Like trying to just make it better, but the root cause is still there. And I believe that once you identify what the root cause is, the solution will be clear already. So sometimes don't jump into like solutioning mode immediately. I think it's important to understand the problem, because once you understand the problem, the solutions will come naturally.
So let me, tilting you. Okay, yeah. Becoming. Yeah. So I want to move to a new question. And I think this is pretty interesting, especially for the students. They are more familiar with B2C. So a lot of things have been said about B2C marketing. In the space of B2B marketing, how can we understand our customers better and generate new leads from marketing?
I can go. Because, I mean, I spent my first 20 years in consumer goods. So it's really B2C. And then the last 4 years, I actually have a mix of both B2B and also B2C. I would say that the principles are actually the same. It's just that from a B2C, you might be, you know, marketing to many, but in terms of, you know, B2B, you're actually marketing, you know, to a smaller audience, you know, in essence. And also the profile of the audience change. So in B2B marketing, like what I'm doing now for HP is, a big part of the customers I'm actually talking to in the enterprise business, they are the CIOs, you know. So the psyche of what makes them tick, you know, what them buy deals is very, very, very different, you know. And it's all more one-to-one marketing. It's more about really, you know, having enough points to really, you know, convince them. So I think the going back to knowing your audience, knowing your customers, what makes them tick, and how do you actually talk to them become really critical. So in B2B marketing, it's no longer about just advertising, digital. Digital is part of that, but it's really also about the nurturing of the cycle becomes longer. So, you know, how do you work with your sales team to make sure that you're helping them nurture the leads? And as a result, they follow up with the leads and really follow through. So in fact, I would say that, you know, B2B marketing is actually even more fascinating, because you really put B2B marketing is really, really simple, right? You know, B2B marketing is really almost like you got to understand the psyche of these people, and then how do you challenge your marketing tactics in a way that is really more impactful?
Actually, it's a very fascinating subject for us, because for Heineken, we are known to be a B2C. But it's a new subject for us that we are really learning a lot. So who are our B2Bs? Our B2Bs are the restaurants and the bars, right? And then we are starting to engage with them. Again, I brought out the handphone solutions. So a lot of these things are going digital. So we're getting them to order beer from us through the handphones. And of course, what happens if they order through the handphones? You get data, right? When you get data, and then depending on the relationship, some of the outlets will give us the full access of when beer is being ordered. I'll give you an example of data analytics. I looked at an outlet and they said, oh, guys, we look at the last 1 month. Every Friday, 10 o'clock to 12 o'clock is your max sales opportunities. Every Friday, 10 to 12, you know, your competitor is selling more beer than you. So what do? Of course, I give every Friday, 10 to 12, special promotion, you know, and I support that. And then I say, look, what else do you need? I'll support it from there. And that makes everyone more happy. But the thing is that all these were not available a long time ago, but only when data starts to exchange, you start to be curious, you start to ask those questions, and you start to see that Friday, 10 to 12 o'clock, is the best time for you to sell beer. Yeah, so just an example of a B2B for
actually
us.
Actually, it's a very good analogy. I remember when I first started joining HP, and then the people be saying, I mean, why are you... Some of the cynics are saying, why is the global CMO recruiting someone from the alcohol industry into B2B marketing?
Right.
But actually, the analogy of marketing to the bartenders and the owners is exactly the same. Because in the alcohol industry, in some markets, we are regulated, like highly regulated, meaning you can't advertise, you can't even brand, you can't even do a lot of things. So when you can't do everything, when you're squeezed to the death, what do? Then you is really talking to the owners, and the whole value exchange on the owners becomes really important. So for me, that curiosity of bringing my learnings to marketing to bartenders, I actually brought it to marketing to, you know, B2B customers, the CIOs, into the applicable. Yeah.
Very good.
I think the good thing about B2B is that you have a smaller group of customers, and a lot of times it's a little bit more intimate and personal selling. You usually have like an area manager who is in charge of a certain client base and things like that. So I think the simplest answer is talk to them. For our B2B clients, includes like the fleet customers. We have customers from like Gojek, Grab, who buys fleet vehicles from us. If you don't understand them, you might think that by lowering the cost of the vehicle, you know, you might entice them by giving a discount. But after a while, we understand that that's not what they're concerned about, because that's just a one-time sale. But they have to carry the vehicle for 10 years, and it is the after sales that is going to cost them a bomb. So then we start to realize that, oh, actually, they are more concerned about the after sales cost, the long-term carrying of the vehicle, rather than the initial vehicle. So I think it's important to just have a frank conversation.
So thank you. So we've covered some questions on B2B. Let's talk about some things that our graduates need to know. What prospects do you see for fresh marketing grads in deep tech and sustainability in the coming 3 to 5 years? What prospects do you see for fresh marketing graduates in deep tech and sustainability in the coming 3 to 5 years? Is there anything? I think Stanley might have something to say.
I think marketing students might, I'm not sure how techy you guys are, but I think for people who are from the conventional side of marketing, you might not be as comparable or techy as somebody who is from engineering and all that. But I think it's becoming more and more important for marketers to understand the digital side of things and how technology works and all that. So I find that moving ahead, there's going to be a lot of new technology that's going to disrupt the market. There's going to be a lot more new marketing digital channels that's going to come on board. There's going to be social media proliferation, new channels and all that. So I think don't be afraid to admit that you're new to this. There's a lot of forums for you to pick up the skills and learn and all that. So I think it's definitely, I think the future looks quite good for someone who is willing to get a little bit more involved in tech and all that. Yeah
I would say that my view on this is I think opportunities are as big as how you want to paint it, right? And how and where your ambition is really going about. I mean, if you look at tech, I mean, within marketing, obviously, I think most of us, we actually come from a bit more pure traditional marketing, but now the role of marketing specialization has evolved quite a fair bit, right? You know, digital marketing. And within the digital marketing, there's whole wealth of different specialization. You know, I think the mindset is really more about what do you want to be? What are you really curious about? You know, and how do you go about pursuing this? I mean, for me, just drawing back the experiences, and I was just talking to Anne and the rest is, you know, 24 years of experience. Prior to that in NTU, my first internship, it actually started with a CPG company. So I was actually interning with Scott Paper, who now is under Kimberly-Clark, right? Kleenex. And actually the marketeers then were ex-Unilever marketeers. So actually I was really happy that NTU sent me for the internship. And it's through those marketeers, I actually learned about, oh, actually the best learning is to start with Unilever and Procter & Gamble, because that's like the school of marketing. So from there onwards, I was really clear, right? Before I graduate, I would say, I want to go to Unilever, I want to go to Procter & Gamble. And that's how my career, you know, in terms of marketing really start. I guess now with all these options of everything from tech to CPG companies to even right down to startups, it's more about what your appetite is and what you think really gets you out of bed and you're really passionate about. Yeah.
Yep, I think first, in terms of digital and sustainability, it's a sure win direction. You know, for all investors are betting, this is the direction to go going forward, for sure. So in terms of industry trend, definitely. But in terms of you saying, hey, I'm a specialist in deep tech, you know, I'm a specialist in sustainability, am I a sure win? And that the answer is what you think is saying. You know, it's as far as you want to go. So it doesn't mean that if you are graduating with a major in sustainability or major in deep tech, you know, you are showing in that direction. Again, people from other disciplines who are interested or if not more passionate and interested and more curious than you in sustainability may end up, you know, being in front row, in a more front row than you in terms of that opportunity. So it still come back to the part about how much you want it, how passionate you are, how curious you are to pursue what you really believe in. So I think it goes back to that. But certainly that direction is a great direction, but I would still not underplay that it's a guaranteed ticket to success. More and more we see more end-to-end is moving around. People are converging together. My own experience for once, I graduated from accountancy and I found myself doing marketing later on in life. So don't funnel yourself as just one funnel.
Thank you. And right now, I would like to invite, open the floor and invite anyone in the audience who would like to ask any questions. We have some vouchers to give away as an incentive, Ichigo vouchers. If anyone would like to ask any questions for the vouchers, maybe I would. Yes, David. Yeah, you have a question.
Yes.
Hi. So, yeah, I think something that was really brought up today was how a lot of brands are attempting to rebrand themselves or change, like adapt to the big changes in the world. And something that's really happened is that big shift in mindset. We want authenticity, we want sustainability. So with that in mind, I think a lot of brands, specifically, like let's say Shell, recently changed their whole identity and brand name. And I think that was such a huge thing, but there was a lot of backlash and not everyone was happy with it. So I want to know what you think and how brands today can really rebrand themselves successfully. And how they do it to appeal to, especially our Gen Z market. Because even today, I can't really think of an alternative.
Anyone have thoughts?
It's deep and broad.
It's a very deep question.
Again, you're saying how, are you asking which brands are successful, or you're saying how brands can be successful?
How brands can really like change their identity successfully.
Right.
So okay. As to be relevant to Gen Z, is that question? Yeah.
I think to me, the manifestation of the brand is not the key point, because a lot of people, they look at whether it's a logo change, it becomes a little bit more contemporary and all that. I mean, that's great. But to me, Changing a brand goes way, way, way deeper than that. It's about changing your entire culture, changing the perception of the brand values, your brand positioning and all that. So I think the question is quite broad, but I think fundamentally, we must first understand why the need for a change. What are the key objectives that you are trying to achieve because of this change? Is it a perception issue that you are trying to address? Or is it in response to competition or brand positioning and all that? And I think with the problem clearer in mind, you will be able to find out how best to go about doing it. Yeah.
I think success first is whether you win the vote of your targeted customers, whether the targeted customers buy whatever you're selling. So first thing is about targeted customers. So you see Gen Z. Gen Z also have different needs and different segments as well. So if you're targeting that, right, success is whether when you're repositioning it, are you positioning and taking the values that they value, and then you position it in the way that you win the votes that you desire. So that's why I say it broad. But if you say how to know whether they're successful, yeah, it's about when you, how close are you knowing the needs of your target consumers and then creating that positioning and let time goes and see whether people are buying, giving you the vote or not by seeing whether your product sells. Does it answer your question?
Yeah, I would think that maybe that question, I was really curious what triggered that question. Was that question triggered because of last 2 years, there was a lot of brand campaigns and especially during pandemic, everybody just come out, oh, I'm good for business and stuff like that, right? Is that the question triggered from that? Okay, I would say that I think what Stanley say is really right is that you got to go back to the customers. And then you got to go back to what the root of the brand stands for and what the values of the brand, almost like a person, right? What your brand the values. And for brands that has been around for a long time, like Heineken brand or HP, or I would say the previous brands I worked off, like Johnny Walker, there are values that are really intrinsic about it. For example, there's usually three words that's all about it. And a lot of time, if that brand becomes the company brand, like Heineken is the brand, but it's also the company brand, it then also is rooted in terms of why you're in business for. And I think Kenneth's example of the Heineken brand is a fantastic example. They reposition in a way that's not in the design, reposition in a way that is making what they stand for as a brand to be relevant with times. You know, and then they make that relevance, you know, consistent, then it becomes true to it. And I would say that's a brand that I'm really passionate about. And I don't know whether do people really know Johnny Walker? Do
keep
you guys
walking.
Know Johnny Walker?
Keep walking.
There is an H. I mean, but it's the most iconic brand I've worked on. And everybody knows Keep Walking, right? Keep Walking, right? And basically, the values of the brand and the positioning of brand is all about men. I mean, around the world, everybody wants to progress, okay? And the positioning is about, you know, Johnny Walker inspires men to progress. But if you go back, and after this, maybe you can Google, you can see how the ads has changed because the progress has changed according to the times, right? There was a period whereby it's all about one man and all the ads is about solitary, you know, progress. And then there was a period that when you're trying to be relevant to Gen Z, it becomes more vibrant. It's about collective progress. And if you look at the last 2 years of advertising, progress becomes very different because when everybody is stuck into this whole pandemic, you want progress that stands for optimism. So you can see that this is a great example that the brand remains consistent to its values, but its definition of its values goes with the time. So I think that would be a great example of a brand that has done great brand positioning just by versus just changing their logos and their, you know, website. Is that what you really stand for as an individual? Yeah. Hope that makes sense.
Yes. I really like that answer because really the brand has a DNA. You can't really change that DNA, but you can kind of reframe it such that its positioning right now is still the same meaning, but you frame it such that it's relevant to what people, you know, really value these days. So I really like that, Johnny Walker.
In fact, I think as opposed to the whole concept of a rebranding, right, your first role is actually to come up with a list of things that you should not change. So these are the fundamentals that the brand would not compromise, and it stands for what you are.
Okay. Thank you so much, David.
Thank you so much.
So do we have thanks any other... Yeah, thanks for being the first brief. So he's a student from my class, by the way.
Okay. Really good question, by the way.
Very good question.
Extra,
yeah, extra additional. Okay, thank you so much, David. We still have some. Oh, we have vouchers, right? We still have more vouchers. Anyone else would like to be a second brave soul? Anyone else has questions? Oh, yes, yay. Oh, would you like to use the mic? Okay, sure. Whatever is most comfortable.
I think to answer your question, the first part, the brand of a company takes decades to build. So it's not like, and I think Prof. Charlene mentioned about it being very inherent. I think some of the speakers mentioned about it like a person, you know, like a personality. So imagine if you are this person and tomorrow I ask you to change to from an introvert to an extrovert, and it's really not possible. So it takes decades to build. So I think, like we shared just now, I think it's important to first understand what you stand for, and there are certain things that you cannot change, because there is going to be dissonance that's brought to whether your employees or your customers, whereby they feel that, you know, the world has changed for them. If this change is a little bit too revolutionary. So there's revolutionary change and evolutionary change. So I think to me, a brand is more evolutionary. So you change little by little, you modern yourself with times and all that. The second part about your question about technology is that I think it's a very, very good question, because a lot of companies, they are so absorbed in tech and IT and all that. And I think it's very important not to let technology rule your company. I mean, of course, unless you're a tech company. So I think a lot of the more conventional or traditional companies, they use digital and they use technology to improve processes, customer journey, customer satisfaction and all that. But they are just tools to satisfy your customers. Don't make it about tech, because that's not the fundamental of, if that's not the fundamental of what your company stands for, right, then don't force yourself to just do that, you know, for the sake of everybody's on digital and all that.
I think first thing you ask, what's my role in this? As leader, as MD of the company, I lead. So the first thing I ask myself, are those values that's stated on the board, am I aligned with those values? Are those my values? If it's not my values, I either shape it differently or I leave the company, right? So those are choices that I make. So at the end of the day, I have to walk the talk. It starts with me, right? And then at the end of the day, the team that goes below is cascaded down. When we talk about values, every day when we do things, if you talk about sustainability. So for example, we talk about plastic. So when we go around and walk the supermarkets, and then we look at our packaging, and we say, hey, look, you know, there's so much plastic in these things. How do we reduce it? So those are the conversations that we have, right to the core. And basically going back and then translating it, walking with the guys, and then there will be emails straight away going down to the supply chain and say, oh, Kenneth wants this plastic to be reduced. So those are conversations starting with the leader first. So you must lead and the rest must follow. And the rest, it must not be rocket science to the rest. Hey, this is new news, and we want to reduce plastic. So Heineken has made a global commitment that we reduce our carbon footprint to zero, to become carbon neutral, zero. So those are conversations that we have said to the whole company, to the said to the external world. That's our commitment. So how I play that role as well is monthly management meeting, annual budget discussion. Hey guys, what are you doing to this? These are the goals that we set. What are we doing to reduce our carbon footprint? What have we done? So that's one example. Another example is our company believe in safety first for the employees. So we start the conversation, any conversation of the meeting, 5 minutes or 10 minutes. Let's talk about the safety status of your department. What are we doing? So that's how you enforce the culture within the company. How would people know? Right? How would people know actually at the end of the day when you walk the talk, then you don't worry about, you know, whether people know or not. Any new joiners, they will just tell their friends, hey, that's how the company works. And that's how it goes from there, at least for my company.
I think I would echo a lot of what Kenneth is saying. I'm trying to think what else should I say differently, but I'm kind of saying like violently agree with what Kenneth is saying. It really starts with the values and the leaders leaving the values and walking the values. And I think another point that I will add in terms of role of marketing is that you cannot be a great marketer if you can't even convince your own employee. So, for example, in all the organizations I've been with, the first thing is when you do a launch, you need to make sure that your employees know what's the high level elevated speech of your product and become brand advocates themselves. In a lot of industries that we've been in, especially in the alcohol industry, you can even see how an MD can be totally obsessed during an event. They can go into the toilet and literally check the cleanliness of everything. So that what I would call the brand passion, it needs to really live with your internal employees, right? And then it becomes really easy for you to advocate that out, because at the end of the day, the employees becomes ambassadors of your brands. They can talk to their friends and the friends and the friends and the friends. So for me, I would say that, you know, the marketing play an even more critical role in terms of internal storytelling and actually getting your employees to become advocates of your products and your brands. Does that answer your question? Yeah.
But the successful companies are the ones that's able to marry this and make a viable business model. You know, if you just run a business just to do a complete ESG and you forget about the value exchanges with the consumers, you make losses. And after a while, you got no money to carry on. So that's not sustainable as well. Yeah.
So thank you very much. I think we're out of time. This was a truly invigorating dialogue session. Thank you, Kenneth, Siu-Ting, and Stanley. I'm sure you've benefited from all their valuable insights. Right, so thank you guys for coming. We hope you'll support our future events. Please keep a lookout for our EDMs that will go out. We will definitely have more invigorating sessions in the future. Thank you so much for being here today. Thank you.